I'm here at Telstra at the economics department and at Telfi. So I'm going to talk about employment or quality of work. We're still not sure about the name of the dimension. We welcome suggestions. But the first question is employment really a missing dimension of poverty? While it's certainly not a new dimension of well-being, employment is sometimes forgotten in human development analysis as a constituent element of individual well-being. Of course, having a good and decent job is associated with being out of poverty, whichever way we define poverty. Work is indeed a prominent indicator of a country's economic performance, but also good quality employment can give a sense of self-respect and fulfillment of life. And as that, we believe it should be incorporated as one of the dimensions of well-being. Now, in terms of the data, the existing data available, which is widely used as a set of international comparable sources, presents, for other purposes, two main weaknesses. First, the standard list of indicators of labor force is based on a model of employment which comes from the developed world that is not as relevant or sufficient to describe the situation in developing economies. Labor Stats is at present the most comprehensive data set of labor indicators. It focuses on the have and have not of a job, employment and unemployment rates, and indicators that are collected mainly for wage employees. But in the poorest economies, most of the poor do work and primarily engage in informal activities. Worldwide, more than 500 million people work, but still live with less than $1 a day. In Africa, South Asia, and Latin America, on average, only 5 to 10% of the active population is unemployed. Moreover, only at most 2 in 5 workers in low-income sub-Saharan Africa have wage employment, whether formal or informal. It is thus imperative to have better information to describe the characteristics of labor force which fall outside the traditional idea of employment, i.e. wage employees, and which can be used to compare labor markets across countries. The second weakness of traditional data of labor force is that surveys that do collect a broader set of questions on employment, that is, the labor force surveys, do not include broad information on the household and its member. Multipurpose surveys, on the other hand, such as the living standard measurement surveys, traditionally include a limited set of questions on employment. Therefore, in terms of data, there seems to be a separation of the spheres of work and household, which prevents a proper characterization of employment conditions in relation to the level of consumption, health, education, dwelling, and other characteristics that make up a person's well-being. Therefore, we propose a short list of indicators of employment to be included in a household survey questionnaire that focuses both on quantity and quality of work. And we stress, again, the need to incorporate these questions into multipurpose household surveys. Now, this list that we have here is meant to complement the traditional indicators of labor force and is in no way substitutes. The first 5 indicators relate to aspects of quality of employment. These are informal employment, income from employment, which includes income from self-employed, which in itself is quite a challenge to collect reliable information, occupational hazard, including not only accidents, but also illnesses and workplace exposures, under and over employment, and the number of activity of the worker. The last indicator relates to the quantity of employment. Is discouraged unemployed, or maybe discouraged worker, as I learned today, is the person who is willing to work, but because of conditions, stops searching. These indicators are not in any sense new, but are nevertheless, at present, not available at an international comparable level, and hence our stress here. Now, once we have this data, what can we do? It can serve us to answer a number of interesting research hypotheses related to individuals' well-being and their deprivation. Some examples, and only some examples, include the study of the extent of gender disparity at work, the strategies of the household to deal with risk in terms of diversification of income generating activities among household members or in terms of their educational choices. The relation of characteristics of employment to consumption levels, life satisfaction, empowerment, both at work or inside the household. And finally, the effect of macroeconomic changes such as globalization and market liberalization on the type of job emerging from it. Thank you very much.